Hey folks, it's Best and Slow. Welcome back to Cryptid Park. In the last video, we added the Mekele Mbembe as our very, very first animal. There it is, poking around. That is our Congo-derived sauropod, basically. Now, today we're getting much, much weirder with it. We always had the problem with this series wherein a lot of the creatures were not going to look like the creature, and we kind of had to use dinosaurs that represented cryptids in a sort of ethereal, slightly less tangible kind of way. Today, I think we've actually done a pretty good job. I want to shout out to Tristan Manuel Silalahi, yeah, who actually gave me the idea for this cryptid and dinosaur combination. They suggested we use the cryptid, the Mapinguari, and it's actually a really cool creature, and also the dinosaur Therizinosaurus. And thankfully, ladies and gentlemen, we do have a Therizinosaurus mod. So I've gone ahead and got hold of that. That's by Digital Duck Modding. I'll link that down below so you can download it for yourselves if you want. I've just remembered, by the way, we have to be super careful. No, we don't. What are we on about? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All the dinosaurs in here. Yeah, right. Just because it's just part mode doesn't mean we don't. Okay, never mind. Anyways, we've got a Therizinosaurus. Now I'm thinking about this. Do I want to do multiple Mapinguaris? And I'll talk to you about the creature a little bit more in a second, but I don't get the impression it's an animal that would have hunted with other animals. However, I think, well, let's make at least one. Let's go from there. I don't mind having just one creature. It's the problem is it's kind of a humongous area. You know, there's lots of room here. Maybe I just make it a little smaller. Maybe you go in here, and then you go along here, and it's like a smaller habitat. We don't need to use all of the area. I guess. the slices thing I think is going to leave lots of empty space. You know what I mean? So if we do like this big slice here, shup, shup, and there's only one animal in the entire thing, maybe we'll just do more animals. Ah, screw it, we'll just do more. It's fine. They can live in a group. I mean, they have to breed, right? Now, I believe the Therizinosaurus does have multiple different colours, so let's pop these out. Whilst that's going on, before we build the enclosure, let's just talk about what the Mapinguari is on a basic level. So, a much weirder creature than last time, believe me. The Mapinguari is a huge, 7 feet tall or taller, hairy bipedal beast that is said to roam the rainforest of the Amazon. Now, its name actually differs greatly amongst all the tribes, kind of like Mekele does a little bit, but it's usually taken to mean either the roaring animal or, my personal favourite, the fetid beast, which is a fantastic name. It is also called, and kind of similar to Mekele, and it had this style name, the thing that has a crooked paw, in reference to its depiction, it's usually having these kind of long, curved, sloth-like claws, and that's kind of half the inspiration for the Therizinosaurus, you know, it has those same claws. As for what the rest of it looks like, well, that also differs quite a lot between different cultures. So as I say, it is typically bipedal, covered in hair, and emits a strong stench. That is one of the common denominators. Always emits a really, really strong stench. No ex-girlfriend jokes here, folks. Sometimes it looks ape-like, including this sort of, you know, stout face and the rounded ears and two front-facing eyes. But sometimes, bizarrely, amazingly, it's depicted as having this huge maw of a mouth. This huge, gaping, fanged, stench-covered maw of a mouth on its actual stomach. As in, it just walks around with a mouth on its stomach that it eats people with. It's amazing. More modern depictions, and more commonly these days, it's depicted as looking very similar to a giant ground sloth, which again is kind of why we've gone towards this Therizinosaurus kind of direction. Therizinosaurus actually looks quite a lot like a giant ground sloth. Interestingly enough, and now we'll begin to make the enclosures. We talk about this. This is me riffing. There was a creature discovered, I think, in the Amazon, but I would not be 100% sure on that one. And it's basically they found some boys found this creature down by the river, and they killed it. They threw rocks at it and killed it. And it was this kind of pink, hairless, bizarre-looking creature with these long, long claws. And it became like a national sensation. It was all over the news, and it became like a new cryptid in and of itself, this beast of the Amazon. And people were staggered as to what it was. And what it actually turned out to be was a sloth, a large sloth that had been born with some form of genetic defect and had lost its fur. And it I'll try to find a picture of it. It was a bizarre-looking creature. I can see why people would see it as something else. Not only was it fairly huge, this sloth, but it was completely pink and hairless. It looked strange, But it also kind of looks like a Therizinosaurus with those claws, and the body shape I think is very reminiscent of a Therizinosaurus. So I can wait. Oh, I was meant to pick three of them. I can totally see why. Well, that's basically why I've got this justification. That's why we're using the Therizinosaurus. And the Therizinosaurus here, the mod we're using, also happens to be hairy. Again, like the Mapinguari. So I think for this habitat, so it's gonna basically you're gonna come in here, and the idea was you follow along here, along the river. Bearing in mind we can't put the track in yet because can we not put the track in yet? Maybe I can put the track in. I just can't finish it, right? Maybe that's the right thing to do. Can we edit the track without deleting the whole thing? I think so. Let's go for it. Let's go for it. Let's live the dream. I want to thank all of you. And so many people left suggestions, like, and just because I've not used it today doesn't mean I'm not going to use it in the future, don't get me wrong. There are tons and tons of really cool ideas, and this just happened to be the one that struck a chord for me today, you know? We'll definitely be back looking at your suggestions again. Feel free to leave more suggestions, of course, but you know, just because you left one in the first video does not mean I will neglect it. I promise you. I will say I did completely forget to name our Mekele and Mbembes. So remember, go onto the QT down below. This means you've got an extra few days to do so. You can go to the QT down below and you can name our Mekele and Mbembes. Just give a sauropod name. If you want to name the. Let me think about this. If you want to name the Therizinosaurus, if you want to name the Mapinguari, then give it a medium herbivore tag, okay? So medium herbivore for Mapinguari, sauropod for Mekele and Mbembe. Right, I think I want this one. We're gonna take a path right deep into the tree line. The Mapinguari, we'll talk about this a little bit more in a little bit. But it is renowned as it's not a nice creature, okay? This is a feared creature, to say the least. I want to make sure I can still edit this track. Yeah, sweet. So let's just connect that onto there. Something like that. I think we'll use the Jurassic Park gates as well because they've got the right kind of look to them, you know? This, oh, King Kong, Lost in the Jungle, big ancient kind of gate feel. I think it's pretty cool. What I might do, if I can find a way, maybe I can commission someone or something. Maybe I can find someone who could change the name Jurassic there to Cryptid. How cool would that be? I'll see if anyone's willing to do it. I don't have any money, but we'll see if anyone's willing to do it. Right, let's have a look at our Ferrozina. So we just wait until the wall. We'll wait until the wall ready. Let's get this path connected. What path were we using? I actually can't tell. I've got like 25 different colours of path. I think this one. Don't know why we're going straight lines, but we are. I'm kind of committed to the idea now. It's obviously not open yet anyway because of the thing. Right, we've got a little hill here. I like that. So we're gonna go a little bit more detail about the Mapinguari. What's the next stage in this? I want to say, by the way, this feels a bit weird. I love that we're doing this in Evolution and we have to get a little creative and have a lot of fun with it. It's gonna make for a cool tour. But it more and more makes me want to do like an individual series just on cryptids because I'm doing all this research on cryptids and then I'm putting it in a Jurassic World Evolution video. It feels a little bit strange. I think we might start a cryptid series. Anyways. So, other than the big old mouth, what else can the Mapinguari do? Well, if we recount the experiences of Domingos Parintintin, yeah, who is a tribal leader in the Amazon. Oh no, in the Amazonas, I should say, which is basically a rainforest-covered state. It's kind of like in northwest Brazil. We can learn a little bit about what this creature can do, and this is awesome. He said, "The only way you can kill a Mapinguari is by shooting it in its head," because it's basically a zombie. No, the reason for that is it's often called has that fur all over its body, as I said, but the fur is meant to be very thick and hardened, and it kind of acts like armor essentially, so you can't even break through it with bullets. So it seems the head is the weak spot of the Mapinguari. That is hard to do because it has the power to make you dizzy and turn day into night. Amazing. The best thing you can do if you see one is to climb a tree and hide. It turns day into night. That's amazing. The creature is said to be fearsome. Unlike many other cryptids, it doesn't back down or retreat from human contact. Instead, it is hyper aggressive, and encounters with the beast are often said to end in violence and like close calls. That and the oft mentioned ability to make you pass out through sheer odor, it's clear why the people of the Amazon fear this beast, and they do. This is a creature that is widespread in its uptake in the Amazon rainforest. People multiple different countries, you know, in the swathe of the rainforest, Brazil, Peru, blah blah blah. Lots of them have tales of the Mapinguari. Anyways, so because of that, because of this, it's this kind of creature that resides in the darkness of the forest, you know? I kind of want to go really heavy on the trees, like super heavy on the trees. Now, I believe the Therizinosaurus eats from high, tall feeder thingies because it's based on the Apatosaurus. Which, by the way, it's a good thing we didn't use the Apatosaurus last time. I think we're going to have a couple of feeders. I kind of want them near the track. I do want you to see the creature because a lot of it is going to be just covered in forest. And then maybe we have like a little river. And the track can follow. I'm gonna have the track like follow the river on one side. And on the other side, the mapping quarry feasts. I like this idea as well. So you see what we've done here? Basically, that should still be up on the hill. Oh, this is pretty. Oh, look at that! Yeah, I like that a lot. I never thought to do that. Because we started not on the hill, the water's kind of like pushing the track around in a very strange way, but I think it looks great. It's gonna make that river follow it all the way along. There we go. Yeah, pretty cool. So you're driving along on this ridge. Look off to the left. Right, I need to cover more tree. I can see fence. That's unacceptable. Still see fence. What we'll do is what we talked about last time, and we'll just use that fence there. This is our invisible fence. It still works perfectly well, still contains all the animals, but we can also pretend it doesn't exist, which is awesome. I kind of want to just obscure the feeder a little bit, but not too much. So that'll do. Yeah, that's fine. You'd think as well they'll come to drink here. What we might do is get rid of all the water that's anywhere else. I also want to clear the tree line a little bit, but only on the right-hand side, essentially. So it looks a bit more like a river. A bizarre river, I'll admit, but still a river. Love that noise of the Nigers in the distance. There we go. And we'll just put a few more back on the other side. It should feel like you're on this dark descent into the labyrinth that is the Amazonian, you know? Should feel claustrophobic and scared from this beast. That's the idea. It's a really cool story, honestly. Like, there's so much about this cryptid that I really like. Mekelle was, I really like Mekelle as well, but as a creature, it's not too exciting because I think we've got a fairly reasonable explanation for it, and it just looks like a dinosaur at the end of the day. This is what you want from a cryptid. You want a mouth in the stomach, the ability to turn day into night. It's amazing. We'll talk about it a little bit more, but our Therizinosauruses are ready, so let's pop them out and have a look. It's actually really good. Look at it. Doesn't it look sloth-like in its proportions? In a way, anyway. It's got the hair all over the body. It looks fetid in a way. It's got those long claws. The scythe claws, as they're called. Scythe, I guess. And that is based on the Apatosaurus. Isn't that incredible work from Digital Dog? Honestly, incredible, incredible work. Blows my mind. Look at that thing. That is, I could see that as a cryptid any day of the week. No problems whatsoever. That is a cryptid right there. Alright. So whilst these are all popping out, I'll tell you what, we'll hop into capture mode for a second. And I will read you my penultimate. Well, not penultimate, nearly penultimate. So, unfortunately, as I say, with most cryptids, Mapinguari likely exists through bedtime stories, myth, and a legend. Excuse me. The similarity, especially in the modern stories, to the giant ground sloths, it's really clear in a lot of the descriptions of the animal. And when Glenn Shepherd, this is an American anthropologist, bloody Nora, spoke to a member of one of the Amazon tribes in 1997, they actually mentioned how the Natural History Museum in Lima, and that's the capital of Peru, had a Mapinguari in their collection, in their fossil collection. Shepherd goes off to the museum, and sure enough, he finds a giant ground sloth, i.e. a Megatherium fossil, in that Natural History Museum. Now, He also did make the. So for him, this was maybe proof that the Mappinguari was basically like ancient tales of the giant ground sloth from their ancestors, because it's a giant ground sloth. The Megatherium spread around the entire bloody continent. It was everywhere. So there's a good chance that the ancestors of some of the people in the Amazonian would have had contact with this animal. And then those stories get passed down and down and down. And then, of course, when people in the West come and show you pictures, it kind of, as with the Mekele and Bembe, it kind of like spreads and becomes a thing of its own. But he makes an interesting point. So, mermaids and sirens of the sea and all this kind of jazz, people kind of accept that mermaids probably aren't real, right? As far as cryptids go, it's probably one of the more widely denounced ones. People probably think that mermaids don't exist. And mermaids, interestingly enough, the myth of the mermaid came about because of manatees. You know, sailors who were stranded at sea for months, years on end, craving the touch of a woman, instead kind of saw these sexy manatees and saw them as beautiful women. What they did to those manatees, I don't want to know, but the point is, they were manatees. And whilst mermaids don't exist, and like the Mappinguari probably doesn't exist, manatees do exist. And Shepard makes the point that, well, just because a cryptid doesn't exist doesn't mean the thing is. What are you? Oh, yeah. So, this is interesting. So, the Therizinosaurus, because it's actually an Apatosaurus and therefore much bigger than the model shows. As you just saw, there's a. This Ranger team just got shredded. But the point is, maybe what they're seeing does exist. And what they're seeing is, of course, a Megatherium. Dun dun dun. It's just an interesting idea. I don't believe there are Megatherians wandering around the Amazon, if I'm totally honest with you, but it's a cool idea. It really is. Could a population of Megatherians. At the end of the day, the Amazon is a big old place, you know, it's a huge labyrinth of darkness and trees and. I had to sneeze, I'm sorry. It's a huge labyrinth, and there are inevitably many species that are yet to be discovered there. Some of them are larger. We're still discovering some larger mammals and stuff in the depths of the Amazon. Something as big as a Megatherium, that seems doubtful to me, but it's a fun idea at the very least. And that's what cryptids for me are about. It's not about realism. I like the idea of hunting for them and using science and stuff to talk about them, but that mystery and that potential is what makes cryptids so exciting, you know? Just that it could happen. You know, there may be what's out there. Who knows? The world is an amazing place, and there are many animals that were once regarded as cryptids that we now know to be real. So, anyways, as the article does remind us, excessive deforestation, unfortunately, has wiped out huge swathes of the Amazon. And you would think by now you would expect some tangible evidence of this creature to have, you know, arrived, especially given it is so popular amongst so many tribes of the Amazon. The Amazon is home to a variety of frankly incredible cryptids. And with a lot of these, oops, legends, the creatures within are often said to punish people who commit bad deeds, and then Mappinguari does the same thing. They become a way for parents to teach behaviors to their kids. A story about a Mappinguari out there in the wilderness may just stop your child wandering off and being eaten by, say, a jaguar instead, you know? Whilst we're here and on the subject, though, the NY Times article that I've been basing a lot of this on, by Larry Rota, by the way, I should have mentioned that before. Mentions an amazing creature called the Boto. Now, that's what he called it. I had a little search for it and found it under a different name, which was the Encantado. This is an incredible cryptid. We probably can't do a video on this one, so I thought I'd just mention it now. This is basically a were-dolphin. You know how you have werewolves and even werebears is kind of a thing? This is a were-dolphin, okay? And by day, they're these helpful pink dolphins that swim around and help guide fishermen. But by night, they turn into men. They, you know, they transform the opposite way into men, covered in white suits and white clothing, and always wearing a hat because it covers their blowhole. I'm not joking here. And what they do, these encantados, is they attend parties in the Amazon, in Brazil, in Manaus. And there, they seduce young, impressionable virgins. Who then go home with the Encantados and assumably get eaten by the Encantado or something like that. By day, a heroic pink dolphin. By night, a man in a white suit with a hat to cover his blowhole who seduces young virgins. And I'm assuming the idea is don't go home with strange men. That's the lesson. Most cryptids try to give a lesson across, try to give a behavior across to the children. You know? It's kind of like the Tooth Fairy. Or Honestly, Santa Claus is essentially a cryptid in some ways, in that he is this mythical creature, sorry kids, who exists to teach children behaviours. And cryptids are largely the same thing. They just happen to be much less humanoid, generally speaking, because at the end of the day, Santa Claus in the Western world, that you're not going to believe that there's a Mapinguari wandering around the streets of London, but you could see Santa Claus, you know? London does, interestingly enough, have some really weird cryptids, including one called Spring-Heeled Jack. But again, he's kind of like just a dude. Anyways, even if it's not real and the Mapinguari is just an example of how stories and these fearful whispers can spread throughout. Even an impenetrable labyrinth of trees such as the Amazon. It's a fairly terrifying and bizarre beast, popular enough that several very real expeditions have been conducted to try to find it. None have returned any evidence so far, but maybe the ones that found the evidence, maybe the ones that found the creature, didn't make it back alive. Dun dun dun! And yes, I scripted the words dun 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 in my video. Right, that is it, ladies and gentlemen. We are done. That is all my Mapinguari information. I'm calling this my practice for starting a proper cryptid series. I'm going to talk about that briefly as we wander around. Bearing in mind, we're not going on the actual tour until the very, very end. We're not touching the vehicles for quite a while yet. Let's have a little peek. Right, can I find one? There's one there, there's two over there, let's go over there. So, I want to talk about my hesitation, because I've long wanted to do a series on cryptids, because cryptids are fascinating to me. There are reasons I've hesitated. One is that I find that a lot of people have done similar already, and they're usually the same thing. People talk about the cryptid, and they slowly zoom in on pictures and stuff like that, right? Some people do this very well. Trey the Explainer does a fantastic series on cryptids. He doesn't upload it very often, but he does incredible stuff on cryptids. Really well-researched and detailed, and honestly, everyone should go check out his channel full stop, because he's a fantastic creator. Anyway. So that's kind of a problem. There's people already doing it in a really good way already. The other idea was to do it, you know, in front of a camera with a blackboard or something, get a proper retro, but there's kind of people doing similar things to that as well already as well. I've said as well too many times there. Shh, it's a Mapinguari. All I need to do now is mod this Therizinosaurus somehow to have a mouth on its stomach. Would that be impossible? Probably not. I mean, it'd be hard, but it wouldn't be impossible. Amazing. I mean, it definitely has that cryptid kind of look to it, doesn't it? The weird limb shapes, the long claws, the hair, the long neck. It's a bizarre creature. That one over there looks amazing. Shh. Remember, the only escape from a Mapinguari, if it finds you, is to climb a tree and hide. Oh god, oh no! It's turning day into night! Oh no! I wasn't quite as slick as I would have liked it, but still. The Mapinguari is here! I wonder where that came from. That's interesting, because the foul stench and... Okay, the mouth is a little bit weird as well, but the day into night is... It's not a physical description of the creature. That's a very real thing. Where the hell have they all gone? What? My point is, like, how would that as a myth come about? Like, how would you believe that happens? Could it be, if I had to guess? So there's this idea that the stench knocks you out. Now the article actually suggests that people who, let's say they go on a hunt and they fail or something like that, that they need a good excuse, and the Mapinguari could be that excuse. Maybe people who get knocked out in some other fashion, people who, you know, are concussed, they fall out of a tree, the coconut lands on your head, whatever it is, you know. Or you're swiped out by another animal. You're knocked out and you wake up later in the evening. Now you don't necessarily know what happened. You don't necessarily have that idea of the passage of time. You don't know that you've been knocked out. Necessarily, anyway. You can wake up sort of dazed and confused and concussed and just kind of like wonder where time has gone. For you, it could be a flash of a second. You know when you nap unexpectedly and you wake up several hours later and you're like, huh, where did the last 4 hours of my life go? Same idea. Day turns into night. That's just speculation, though. Right. Anyways, that is the Mapinguari. It's really cool. I recommend everyone go read lots about it. There we are. Yeah, at daytime you bloody show up again, don't you, buddy? The music isn't dramatic enough. I need to mod in some, like, scary music or something. Alright, so again, I'm more than open to suggestions. You gave me loads of great suggestions on episode 1. I'm definitely going to go back and check those. But if you've got any more ideas, feel free to drop those down below. Cutie, medium, herbivore, I believe it is, for the map and quarry. Remember, this is a fearsome beast. And also, again, if you want to keep leaving Mekelle and Bembe names, you can do that. Although I will be favouring the people who left names last week, because I think that is the more fair way to do it. But again, the cutie description and Sauropod. If you're enjoying this series, you appreciate the work, and if you think this is cool, please do hit the like button and all that. You don't need to comment. I know comments take effort, but just hit that like button. It really does help me out. It doesn't cost anything, and helps the video perform a little better and all that kind of jazz. I would super appreciate it. And subscribe for more of this malarkey. There you go. Remember to smash that like button, bros. I can't do it. Cryptid thing. That's the last thing I want to say. So, my challenge at the moment is I'm trying to come up with a unique way to tackle cryptids in a way that hasn't been done before. A way to bring you the information, but in a new light. Right now, I'm not sure what that is. I've got a slight idea, a very slight idea, and that is to write short stories about the cryptids. I always loved that idea of doing like 3,000 word stories or something on each individual cryptid, maybe eventually putting it together into a volume. And the problem with that is it would be really interesting, but I think it would lack all the information that people want from those videos. I don't know. If anyone has any ideas, feel free to hit me up. But that is kind of my issue right now. I need a unique way to tackle the subject before I feel comfortable doing videos on it, I guess. But we'll see. Maybe I'll just do what everyone else does. Thank you so much for joining me either way for the mapping quarry. I'll see you lovely folks next time for whatever. Who knows what it'll be next time. Cheers much as always. Bye-bye.